You hear me?
Well, thank you, Alex. Alex,
that phone doesn't work. You have to show.
Thank you. Okay. That's all right. She's leaving. It's not coming out of the damage deposit or anything. Alice always does a great job of going through a good rendition of the issues that are facing us in the legislature. I've learned a lot from her and from Ellen over the years. It was that street right up there on top of the hill. There's a couple blocks up there, Hoyt, where I first went door knocking with Ellen for the first time and met her. Because a friend of ours said, hey, she's going to be a great senator, and she is a great senator from Minnesota. Take it away, Ellen. I'll let you get an applause. And it's really sad to see her go. I've learned so much from Ellen and from Alice. They've been great teachers and mentors. They've taught me a lot. Maybe they've taught me too well. And I just can't, it's difficult for me to think of our team changing, because I think we've had a fantastic team. I will say that this legislative session, Alice spoke about a lot of things that are going on, but I need to say, rather than rehash my perspective on all those items, because I think Alice hit it spot on. When people ask me, why are we in this position again? Why does it seem like we're constantly on a cycle of not just boom and bust, but permanently bust? I tend to be more of a big picture guy. I tend to like to look at why we're having a problem and then go through it and determine how we can fix it to get to the root of the problem. Well, when I have folks come into my office and talk about what they want to happen, constituents that want to happen this particular legislative session, in previous years, this year, what have you, sometimes those items cost money, and they'll have what we call a fiscal note, and nothing's generally moving through committee if it has a fiscal note, if it costs any kind of money, because we don't have any money. Well, it's been that way for years. There was only one year in the past 8 that I've been there that we had any kind of money to work with. It was during that time we were able to get some really good stuff passed, the money for the Praxis audit, which resulted in the bridges to safety that many of you see down at the courthouse, and the blueprint for safety for domestic violence was fantastic. That was a bright spot of light in an otherwise bleak landscape of things, of items that we've pushed for but haven't been able to make happen. Ellen and I worked really hard on the paid sick days initiative, ensuring that folks have an opportunity to have paid sick days in Minnesota. Only 41% have paid sick days. That had a fiscal note attached. That didn't happen. My concern is, why is it that we can never have the opportunity to affect real change, even if it costs a modicum of money? Because most of the time, the rewards are high multiples of the initial investment that we actually put in. Well, in 2000 and 2001, people may remember, we were on the heels of fantastic dot-com bubble, housing bubble was still growing at that time. We were flush with cash. And Jesse Ventura was fond of reminding people that he stood up on the steps of the Capitol and said, give it back. I do my Jesse Ventura imitation, but you all wouldn't like it. He said, we're taking in too much money, give it back. Well, we did give back chunks of surplus checks. Many of you remember the surplus refund checks that you got from the state government and the federal government at that time. We also did something else, though. We changed the tax rates. We killed the goose that laid the golden eggs. That was a goose that provided for reinvestment in our communities, the infrastructure upon which businesses rely for educated workers to move their product, for research and development technology. All these things are investments, reinvestments, not just in balancing the budget for the current biennium, but for how our children are going to live in our neighborhoods 20 years from now, 50 years from now. And that was all changed in the name of, we're doing things wrong in the state of Minnesota. So starting in 2000, 2001, we short-sheeted our bet to the tune of about $1 billion a year in tax revenue. Now, you can think it's a coincidence or not that seemingly the aggregate of every year since then, we've grown about another $1 billion worth of deficit in the red. But the fact remains, that if we didn't do that, we wouldn't be in this position now. Now, when I talk to my GOP friends across the aisle, they say, you know what? Wrong idea. This is not your money, government. This is our money. We need to keep more of it in our pockets. And it's a basic philosophical difference. I don't like paying taxes. I don't like having to give away money as much as anyone. But the fact is that we're standing in this pavilion, around this lake, around bike trails that go all the way around. There are buses that go through our neighborhood to take us downtown. We have water that we can drink from the taps coming out of our faucets. Spending some time in the nations that I have that don't have that same access, I tended not to take it for granted as much. So starting in 2001, we short-cheated our own bid. And the problem is that there's a complete and wholesale refusal to change that problem. And we've cut all the way down to the bone where there's no more resources where we can draw from. Now, as Alice correctly stated, the tax bill that was proposed this past session that just came through Representative Rudbeck's committee proposed wholesale cutting of local government aid from the Twin Cities, Minneapolis, St. Paul, and Duluth. The problem with this is that it is going to drive your property taxes up. Statewide, that bill that they propose will drive up property taxes to the tune of $1 billion. They know that, they realize it. House nonpartisan research staff has stated on the record multiple times that routinely, for every dollar of local government aid that's cut, 67 cents rises in property taxes. It's just a fact. Now, the other side of the aisle will state that, and when I say this other side of the aisle, the fact is we're in a position in this government where you've got the government and then you've got the opposition. And that's what we're doing here. In order to vet issues, we need to call it, say it like it is. The fact is the other side of the aisle right now is proposing a bill that's going to drive up your property taxes. But even worse than driving your property taxes, it's going to cut police and fire throughout the city of St. Paul. It's going to cut parks and libraries to the point where they can't afford to be cut anymore. And make no mistake about it, the rec centers, the parks, the after-school opportunities are public safety too. They absolutely are. Ensuring that our kids have opportunities for activities after school. I guarantee you, as a kid, some of you around here know the stories about me when I was a kid. If I didn't have things to do after school, I was getting in trouble. And many of my friends' kids are the same way. You give our kids an opportunity to do something after school, it's completely critical. Local government aid is the key to making that happen. The other items outside of the travesty of the tax bill this legislative session include, as Alice talked about, House File 1, which talked about gutting and is proposing to gut environmental regulations, the regulatory process throughout the state of Minnesota. Now, business in and of itself obviously doesn't like to be regulated. Just like no one likes paying taxes, no one likes to be regulated. But it's not a question if you yourself want to be regulated, it's a benefit for the rest of us. Companies need to be held accountable to ensure that they're not dumping things so that we, in the drinking water, so that we do have clean drinking water when we can open the tap and take a drink out of it. But House File 1 completely circumvents the process. In that same committee, they're proposing multiple avenues for what they call tort reform. And tort reform is removing your opportunity to have access to the courts if you're injured, if you're wrong, if you're a farmer on your land and you do have a polluted groundwater, if you do have a local business that is in conflict with how you're running your business as a farmer. So local farmers in western Minnesota and other parts of the state are opposed to this, but it's being railroaded through as the principle that it's the benefit to business. So these are the items, some of the things that I'm working on this session, but I think the preeminent issue is the question of revenue. Right now, there are no more places that we can cut in the state of Minnesota, and be fair, other than cutting the local government aid that supports our services in the city, including police and fire and parks and libraries. And no mistake about it, it is a completely partisan bill. There is no question. The only places on the map where they're cutting in this tax bill are blue places. And the only places that are benefiting are red locations, are red squares on the map. It's shameful. I don't, we absolutely, it's politics at the Capitol, there's no question about it, it happens all the time. But this tax bill is so blatantly and transparently partisan, it gives Governor Dayton the opportunity to completely reject it out of hand and does not need to negotiate whatsoever. So when you weigh in with folks, I mean, obviously Ellen and Alice and I are your legislators, we're on the same team, but we still need to hear from you. We still need to hear from you and how you rely on the parks, how you rely on the schools in St. Paul. And everyone has a different story, because the statistics that Alice mentioned, those are all important. Those will get you on the agenda at the Capitol. But the only thing that ever really moves the legislation, that really gets it to pass, is a compelling story about how it affects you and your life, how it affects your kids, how it affects your grandkids. And those are the resources and the fuel upon which Alice and I and Ellen rely when we go in, when we speak with passion to effectively organize the things that keep us awake at night enough to be poring over those documents to ensure we're well prepared for committee are the stories that you talk about. So thank you for those stories, and I hope you continue on with them as we go through. And Alice, we're going to do some Q&A.